It was good fun. It was just good boys' fun, yeah. I joined the police force because my father and brother and my uncle had all been policemen. Members of the Armed Robbery Squad at that time would go and ask you to apply to be a member of the Armed Robbery Squad. And that's how it worked. It was all, you were picked to go and then you applied and then got the job. I mean, in those days we were getting three bank robberies a week and you had terrified tellers, you had shots being fired and it needed to be stopped. And the hierarchy of the police force came down to the Armed Robbery Squad and said, stop it. We went out pretty hard. I mean, we had carte blanche to do what needed to be done. So yes, there was fear of us. And we went to Perth to extradite one fellow for three bank robberies, and he saw us and grabbed a glass from the table and thrust it in his guts and stabbed himself in the guts with the glass. And he said, I don't want to go back with him. You know, I know what the consequences will be. I don't want to go back to Victoria. No, nothing shocked me. I was one of those young blokes that I'd been shooting and killing and that sort of stuff, so nothing worried. I had no effects of death or anything like that, so. Yeah, well, that night, sort of the 36 hours later, I was pretty exhausted and tired, obviously, and coming home, I dropped the rest of the crew home to their homes and coming home to where I was going. And I was holding my head out the window like a dog, you know, to get the wind in the face to keep awake, and finally got home and just collapsed on the bed in what I was wearing and took the revolver out of the holster and put it to my immediate left, as usually did, and on the bedside table, and just collapsed on the bed and went to sleep. And my wife came down the hallway and I picked up the revolver and pointed at her through the bedroom door. And she said, it's me, it's me. And I put the gun down and went back to sleep. However, in hindsight, when she came 3 or 4 hours later, pardon me, and banged on the wall on the way down the hallway, I said, well, what are you doing? She goes, you almost shot me last time. And I said, no, that was a dream. That's when I thought it's time to move on in careers, because if I had a shot her dead and gone back to sleep, who would believe me? My career was a result of those incidents at the Armed Robbery Squad and my first wife, and a combination of things that weren't right and weren't comfortable with. And you can sit there in hindsight and say, you know, you can see the signs coming. So I made a decision that, and plus the police force made a decision that, you know, I'd reached my use-by date. So I resigned. When you look back in hindsight, you know, so we just used up, spat out as just mere names and numbers, you know, replaceable. And no one cared about the consequences to, you know, the marriages, the mental health, the what's known now as PTSD. It was full on. It was just full on. I moved on in life, and you know, I had an interest in the law, so be it good or bad or indifferent, I had that interest. So I thought I'll go to law school, and I did, and became a lawyer. So I became a lawyer because of two reasons. One, I needed to set my own head straight as to what I'd been involved in, to what I wanted to be involved in. I was having a military career at the time as a lawyer, as a legal officer, and I wanted to make sure that, you know, that all I was heading in is the right side of the line. So I just did things straight down the line.
There's really no words to describe the hollow feeling that I felt when I found out. I felt sick to the stomach.
Yesterday she spoke out about a male army officer cadet setting up a Skype cross and then filming her having sex with him and broadcasting it live to six other cadets.
There was a situation where two of the six cadets were charged, but there was eight involved in this alleged viewing of this Skype incident. some of those were under 18, some of them were 17. And the ADF have a regard that they have to look after juveniles, and a juvenile being under 18, and they didn't. They intimidated and falsely imprisoned these two young blokes in particular, where they kept them apart from other people and slammed their fists on the desk, kept them awake for an extraordinary amount of period of hours that shouldn't have occurred. And to me, that's false imprisonment and should never have occurred. And there was one particular captain who was an ex-military policeman said to me, you don't understand what this is all about. And I said, I understand perfectly. You get yourself a good criminal lawyer, you need one. You know, because I was hell-bent on seeing this prick face up for what he'd done.
Defence lawyer Brian Cook unsuccessfully opposed bail conditions that require McDonald and Blackie not to approach the officer cadet known as Kate or to make contact with other cadets allegedly involved.
Are you happy with the bail conditions?
That's probably a matter for the court. Do you think it's completely unworkable, their bail conditions?
I've raised more issues with the court. The court made a decision, we'll stick with it.
And do you think you can defend these charges?
We'll make that defence, yes.
And that's cemented my position that I'd taken this stance, this new stance of, you know, I couldn't care less about your attitude. The rules are the rules, and this is what the rules say, and this is what's going to happen. So I'd taken a degree of difference from the police force days of, you know, indifferent attitude, cavalier attitude, to one of strict, these are the rules and you follow them regardless of the consequences type attitude. We had enormous wealth of informers. Each crew had its own informers. So we had, for example, Chopper Reed.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's a slug in this gun. Now, you're going to take my word for it, but there's a slug in this gun. Well, I want one shot to my head. One shot to Renee's. Are you ready, Renee?
I don't think I want to play.
Are you ready? You don't want to play. Bad luck.
But he was bloody dangerous too. He needed to get out of jail early. So I spoke to the governor, who rang me and said, it's an opportunity arising. Do you want to talk to him? I said, I'm more than happy to. So we got him out of jail 3 weeks early before the public knew he was out. It was the old system in those days. You know, those things happened. You could make them happen.
In 1987, he shot and killed Sam Ossicombe outside a St Kilda nightclub. He was acquitted on the grounds of self-defence.
We gave him a bulletproof vest to wear. As a result, we'd rather him alive than dead. So he's more used to us alive, obviously. So he was wearing that vest the night he had the altercation with Osnacan, and Osnacan didn't survive the altercation. We had a pretty good working relationship with the City Watch House. Where he was incarcerated after the homicide, the squad arrested him. But prior to that, the homicide squad had made known to the special operations group that they needed to get him in for the shooting. They wanted to charge him with murder. And we didn't have a good working relationship with the homicide squad. We used to treat them as what we used to call the domestics. You know, that's all they solved was domestic homicides, and they hated it with a passion, and we didn't like them. They didn't talk to us, we didn't talk to them, and that's just the way it was. And we had a homicide squad bloke attached to our squad for a while because we had involved in so many shootings, and unfortunately he took his own life. It was unfortunate. He's a lovely bloke, but that was life. For whatever reason he did that, I don't know. So a result of Chopper getting wanted by the homicide squad, they let be known to the SOG that if he didn't surrender himself the next morning, then they would come after us via homicide squad to grab me, my crew, and Chopper Reed at a park the next morning. Did he not surrender? Well, the SOG bloke owed me a favour, and he told me this is what the plan was, and we were mortified by that plan, that that would have ended up in a shootout, no doubt about that at all. But thankfully it didn't occur. The chopper agreed when I said to him, you need to surrender yourself to the homicide squad, and he agreed to do that. And I said to him, look, they're not like us. They're totally different to an armed robbery squad detective. You need to understand that. He surrendered himself and dealt with it. So we got him a lawyer when he was incarcerated in the City Watch House. The City Watch House staff gave him access to Margaret. So Margaret came and visited him for a while. So they said their farewells, and then he went to trial and found not guilty. So win-win, as far as we're concerned. And A, we didn't have to shoot out with the homicide squad or the SOG, and we would have come probably second in that little shootout if that had occurred, and that's life. So, I mean, the gangland wars were as a result of probably a number of concluding shootings. I met them earlier, like Alphonse Gangitano. I met him as when I was still in the crime car squad days. That I remember him sitting on a floor at Russell Street crime car squad office with a bin on his head, smacking it, going, "I'm a stupid fucking wog. I'm a stupid fucking wog," because he was. He punched a young policeman out, for no reason in Carlton. King hit him, and he was just. He was just a nobody, Alphonse. But, Chopper, when he got out of jail and before he was well known to being out of jail, he walked into the Chevron Hotel in St Kilda Road with a stick of gelignite, a bit of AN60 gelignite with a fuse in it. And the fuse was burning, but no detonator. Throwing it up, tossing it up and down and catching it and yelling for Alphonse, and Alphonse was there. And Alphonse escaped by going through a toilet window and cutting himself quite badly on the way out of the window. Pretty well straight to the airport and flew to Italy.
4:30 on an October morning, 1988. Gunshots echo down a dark suburban street.
A tragic and violent end to brief lives and brief careers in the police force.
Shots that haunt police to this day.
Yeah, the Walsh Street killings took place after all this. They were as a result of the continued activity of what was said to be the armed robbery squad activity as payback. And they were the unwritten rules of the day, was that you don't touch wives, family, girlfriends, brothers, sisters type stuff. If you've got a problem with the armed robbery squad, you take it to the armed robbery squad. If the armed robbery squad have a problem with you, they'll come to you. But you don't involve others, and that's when the rules got bent and broken. But that was a breaking of the rules. That was the start of the decline, and then it was free for all. It was just on. Yeah. You shoot at us, you fire one shot at us, we'll fire 20 back at you. Don't take us on because you won't win. And they didn't. No one won.